Good morning. What did Jesus mean when he said to his disciples, "Have salt in yourselves"? Let's look at this passage. This is the Gospel of Mark, verse 42 to 50. But whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to stumble, it would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life maimed rather than having two hands to go to hell, into the fire that shall never be quenched, where their worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. And if your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame rather than having 2 feet to be cast into hell, into the fire that shall never be quenched, where their worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. And if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye rather than having two eyes to be cast into hellfire, where their worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. For everyone will be seasoned with fire, and every sacrifice will be seasoned with salt. Salt is good, but if the salt loses its flavor, how will you season it? Have salt in yourselves and have peace with one another. So this is quite a passage here. And you know, if you look at it, the focus is what? You and I separate completely from sin. It's very urgent. This is a very urgent warning from Jesus. No matter what it costs you, no matter what you must give up, separate from sin. This isn't a passage, by the way, about cutting off your arm or cutting out your tongue or plucking out your eye. That's not what's going on here. He's saying that the desperate need we have to get rid of sin is as urgent as having to do those kinds of things. Now, some have taken this passage, by the way, and have said, oh, look, this is teaching an immortal soul that burns forever. Here's it's teaching hellfire. Listen. I don't think so. Let's look at the context of it. What's going on, again, is this issue of getting rid of sin at all cost. So then what about this business about the fire that isn't quenched and the worm that doesn't die? What about that? And remember that in Genesis 2, verse 7, God takes the dust of the ground and he pulls it together with the breath of life that he puts together. When he puts it together, you get one unitary being. That's a person becomes a living soul or a living being. You have to have both pieces. In other words, we don't have a soul that God puts into us. We are a soul by the Bible. I know what Hollywood says. I know what's common in Christianity, this teaching of an immortal soul. But the Bible also says that immortality is a gift that we receive. And not everybody gets this gift. So immortality is something that we don't have innately. Now, what about the passages here that he's quoting from? Well, he's quoting from some passages in Isaiah. If you go to Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 66, the last chapter in the book of Isaiah, that's where you get this, the worm that doesn't die and the fire that's not quenched. If you look at that chapter, you find that the redeemed are walking out. God has remade the world, and they're walking out into the new world. And it says there they're going to walk on the corpses of those that were wicked. And so that's kind of the context of it. The earth, if fire burns and the earth is remade new at the end. And so that's what you have going on there. So if you go back like to Isaiah 14, verse 11, we have this description of Satan being burned up through the picture of this king. But what you have going on there, again, is this picture of the maggots spread under you and the worms over you. It's a picture of eternal judgment, eternal destruction. They'll come and look at your corpse, God tells, and the leaders of the earth will come out and look at you, you who deceived them, and that Satan, he's brought down to the ground. And so this is just talking about being cut down into the put into the grave. Cut down from your high place. Satan wanted to ascend above the heights of the clouds and be worshipped like God, but instead he'll be brought down to the very depths of the grave. So that's what's going on here. This is not teach. No, nowhere in the Bible is the worm put as a symbol of the soul or is the soul likened to a worm. That's just weird stuff. That's not what Jesus meant. That's not what Mark meant, and that's not what this is teaching. Now it also says near the end of the passage here, it talks about every sacrifice will be seasoned with salt. And so you know that when the sacrifices were given, they were salt was put in there. And salt was that which preserves. Jesus is telling us we need to be have his grace, his power, his strength in us so that we will be preserved from evil. Let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, help us to heed the lesson here in this passage about sin. We need to be totally removed from sin. Please, Lord, do that work in us. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. This is real serious. So let's take care of that. Let's let the Lord bless us and have a wonderful day in Christ Jesus.